just bad policy, it's against the common good.
It's gone on
far too long.
Yes, it's gone on
far too long.
I tell you, it's gone on
far too long.
Oh, somebody's hurting our families, and it's gone on
far too long.
And we won't be silent anymore. And we won't be silent anymore.
And we won't be silent anymore.
So this is a service of prayer, commitment, and setting forth. We need to send our leaders out on their journey. And so I ask for Dr. Forbes, Dr. Barber, Reverend Blackmon to come up. And I ask the clergy, the imams, the rabbis, the pastors, and the leaders of other faith traditions to come and surround them with the laying on of hands. And I ask the rest of us that are here in this house of worship today to reach forward, and we will lay on hands and send these leaders forth.
My friends, economic sustainability, living wages, is a moral issue. Education is a moral issue. Healthcare is a moral issue. The environment is a moral issue. Addressing the disparities in our criminal justice system that impact black, brown, and poor white people is a moral issue. Protecting and expanding voting rights and immigrant rights and LGBTQ rights and women's rights and Native Americans and labor issues, those are moral issues.
Black lives matter. White lives matter. Jewish lives matter. Muslim lives matter. Buddhist lives matter. Atheist lives matter. They're all my children.
We are here because our nation has lost its way, and it is our responsibility to help them find their pathway back. We are here because our news waves in the middle of an election are inundated with hateful rhetoric. Instead of talking about homelessness and health care for all.
Where is our moral voice? Where is our willingness to stand up and say, we the people can make change happen if we stand together? That may be just the kind of wall that we do need. A wall of people who can bring joy and understanding.
And we are going to be one nation or no nation. Vote together. Organize together. Fight for the heart of this nation. Hallelujah. Find the glory.
Forward together. I want you to yell back, not one step back, okay? Forward together. Well, that was halfway okay. And the reason that was halfway okay is because we normally do this standing together. And what we've always said is that we stand together because we stand together, right? So let's stand together. And let's try it. And I do want you to know that this is just warm up for you singing, right? Okay, just kind of opening you up a little bit. Oh, there's a method to the madness. All right, forward together.
Not one step back.
Come on, come on, come on, a little more powerful than that. Forward together.
Not one step back.
You're getting there, you're getting there. One more time. Forward together.
Not one step back.
That's it, right there, that's it. And so, where are the altos in the house, y'all? Where are the altos? Don't take it back now. Where are the sopranos? What? Oh, where are the tenors? Bass, baritone. And then we reserve the special category called I don't know. where are they? And then there are those shower alto soprano tenor bass baritone. Where are you? Okay, all right. So we need to hear you tonight. Want you to put a little harmony with what you hear. We're gonna start off saying we're missing some people. Where are our young people? Liz, where are our young people? There they are. Let's give them a hand, y'all. Right down here, right here. And I want you to know I didn't have to twist their arms. They asked, could they sing? So when we teach our children to fight, it's in them, right? It's in them. Trust me, it is. Okay, and so tonight we're going to sing together. We're going to do a little call and response. You know, I'll call to you, you respond back just like we did in rehearsal just a second ago. And the first song we're going to do is Woke Up This Morning With My Mind Stayed On Freedom. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on freedom, right? Okay, so here's what I want to do. We'll work on that. All right, here we go. I woke up this morning with my mind
stayed on freedom.
Yeah, I woke up this morning with my mind
stayed on freedom.
I said I woke up this morning with my mind
stayed on freedom. Hallelujah.
Well, I woke up
have our minds stayed on freedom. Is that right? So we're gonna do a song right now that I heard as a little girl from my faith tradition. I heard it from the mothers who used to sit over in the corner, and I promise you, I thought they were making up those songs, and they were. Some of them actually were. And those songs would do what they call catch fire. All right. And so somebody would start singing it, and they didn't have another verse, and the person next to them would take the song and would catch fire, right? And so this song is, come on, come on, come on. Now, as a child, I heard, don't you wanna go? But because the ancestors have given us license to tweak some of the songs based on our needs, we now say, come on, come on, come on, don't you wanna vote? And so the words will go, come on, come on, come on, don't you wanna vote? Come on, come on, come on, don't you wanna vote? Come on, come on, come on, don't you wanna vote? Yes, I wanna vote. All right? So this is a catch fire song. Ready? Come on, come on, come on, don't you wanna vote? Come on, come on, come on.
Don't you wanna vote?
Come on, come on, come on.
Come on, come on, come on.
Come on, come on, come on.
Come on, come on.
Friends, no tyranny finds support without tapping into our fears. Fear weakens us and destabilizes us. It destroys our spiritual and psychological defenses, anesthetizing us to the suffering of others and, in the end, making us cruel. We cannot be citizens who are tempted by the false security of physical or social walls. Walls that enclose some and banish others. Walled citizens terrified on one side, excluded, exiled, and still more terrified on the other. Is that the life that God wants for us?
No.
No. Categorically not. In these words of Pope Francis in a speech delivered just yesterday, we find what draws us here together tonight. We want to be people who reject fear and embrace hope. People who call on each other to step up for what is right, mercy, justice, peace, and love. And so tonight, I welcome you to the nave of the Riverside Church. I'm Amy Butler, the senior minister, and it's my honor to have all of us here in this holy place where calls for justice have rung out at critical moments in our shared life, as they will tonight on the eve of a historic election that will set the course for the future of our country. With a shared commitment to dream of what we can be together, let us pause now to pray. Good and gracious God, you who gives us our very breath and who calls us to step up and out for your justice, we invite you to be with us this night. Banish our hopelessness and quell our fears. Imbue us with the courage to tell the truth and to demand a change that becomes tangible reality, so that together we may reflect the best of who we were created to be. For this we pray. Amen.
Good evening. At this time, I would like the folks that are going to be a part of the litany to come join us at front. And as they're making their way to the front, if folks want to fill in, get a little closer so we can be in revival together. I want to also say that as we are gathered here, there are 21 watch gatherings happening across this country of this revival service, this call for prayer, conscience, healing, action, and to vote. Folks are in Oakland, California, New Haven, Connecticut, Indianapolis, Indiana, Topeka, Kansas, Louisville, Kentucky, Lexington, Kentucky, Annapolis, Maryland, Kansas City, Missouri, Jackson, Mississippi, Durham, North Carolina, Raleigh, North Carolina, Goldsboro, North Carolina, Greensboro, North Carolina, Madison, New Jersey, Cincinnati, Ohio, Warwick, Rhode Island, Houston, Texas, Pasco, Washington, and Madison, Wisconsin. So if folks here would just give a round of applause, maybe wave to the cameras, we know that we're being watched all over this nation. And let us start our litany.
On April 4th, 1967, in this, the Riverside Church in the city of New York, Martin Luther King preached, "We as a nation must undergo a radical revolution of values. We must rapidly begin the shift from a thing-oriented society to a person-oriented society. When machines and computers, profit motives, and property rights are considered more important than people, then the giant triplets of racism, militarism, and materialism are incapable of being conquered."
Sent out from this church on April 3rd, 2016, the revival. Time for a moral revolution of values has traveled around the nation, listening to the cries of the people, hearing the hard truths of deep poverty, racism, homophobia, xenophobia, the lack of access to health care, the trials of predatory lending, the horrors of police violence and mass incarceration, and the destruction of our land and water.
The moral revival has visited 22 communities, connected tens of thousands of community members, and gotten thousands of people, including more than 3,000 interfaith clergy and faith leaders, to sign on to the Higher Ground Moral Declaration.
The moral revival, time for a revolution of values, has heard the call from faith and community leaders to focus on the real moral issues of our day. Voting rights, workers' rights, immigrant rights, the rights of indigenous people, the rights of religious minorities, women's rights, the right to health care, housing, education, and the affirmation of the dignity and righteousness for all. We have heard the prophet's call to repair the breach, and we know our Constitution's goal of a more perfect union.
We reach back to our sacred texts that affirm love, love, and justice. This is what the Lord says: do what is just and right, rescue from the hand of the oppressor, the one who has been wronged. Do no wrong, our ancestors are our honor, our fathers, and our widow, and do not shed innocent blood.
We affirm the prophets and proclaim, doom to you who legislate evil, who make laws that make misery for the poor, that rob my destitute people of dignity, exploiting defenseless widows, taking advantage of homeless children.
We uphold dignity and respect for all from the Quran. Wal mu'minun wal mu'minat ba'duhum awliya ba'din yahmiruna bil mahrufi wa yanhauna 'anil munkar. The believers, both men and women, are responsible for one another, all enjoin the doing of what is right and forbid the doing of what is wrong.
We challenge those who claim so-called evangelicalism is only concerned with prayers in public schools, abortion, and homosexuality, remembering that Jesus preached, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoner and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor."
From this very pulpit, nearly 50 years ago, Dr. King preached, "There comes a time when silence is betrayal. The truth must be told."
And the truth is that more than 250,000 people die from poverty and a lack of education each year in the United States, and that millions of children are homeless, lack adequate food and housing, and don't have quality education. There comes a time when silence is betrayal. The truth must be told.
Llega un momento en que el silencio es traición. La verdad ha de ser dicha.
And it's
And the truth is that voting rights are being eroded after the 50 years after the passage of the Voting Rights Act, that systemic racism plagues America as extremists drum up bigotry and hatred, that in many communities it is more likely that teenagers will end up in prison than graduate from high school.
But we also believe this to be true. All people have inherent rights, and no one can take them away.
Todas las personas tienen derechos inherentes, y nadie puede llevárselo.
We have the right to life, to liberty, to enjoy the fruits of our labors, and to the pursuit of happiness.
We believe that the power of our governments derive from us, the people.
For the purpose of providing for the general welfare and protecting our human rights.
We believe in the values of democracy we were taught, so we cannot accept our democracy's feeble state.
We cannot accept voter suppression and intimidation targeted people of color.
We cannot accept demagoguery and fear-mongering that demonize and divide.
We cannot accept that half of the U.S. population are poor or low-income and rich as this country.
Or that 1 in 5 children are food insecure.
We cannot accept wages that don't provide for a decent life, or the suppression of workers' rights to organize and bargain collectively.
We cannot accept segregation and inequality in our public schools or the attempt to privatize profit.
We cannot accept that 29 million Americans don't have health insurance, including more than 4 million denied Medicaid expansion by their states.
We cannot accept inaction in the face of climate change and the disproportionate impact of the ecological crisis and impoverished communities, nor suppression of the rights of those protecting our border and land. We cannot accept that 1 in 3 black men born today can expect to spend time in prison, nor that our country holds 1/4 of the world's prisoners, but only 1/20 of its population.
We cannot accept endless war, which spends lives and resources only to destroy lives.
We cannot accept attack on our neighbors, immigrants, indigenous people, religious minorities, people of color, lesbian, gay, bisexual, trans, and queer folks, the disabled, or the poor.
We cannot accept the way things are because we haven't given any more vision out there for speech.
We are here to summon the better angels of our nature and press together to higher ground. We are here to revive the heart of our democracy. We are here to get engaged and to prepare to cast our ballots for justice and morality. We are here to call to prayer, a call to conscience, a call to healing, a call to action, and a call to vote.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
We now have a chance to hear back from our four revivalists who have traveled to 22 different places over the course of 7 months, heard from thousands of people, and revived the heart of our democracy together. We will have a chance to watch brief videos of some of the powerful testimonies that have been shared with us on the road, and some of the powerful sermons and words of encouragement that the four revivalists have had to share with communities across this country. We're seeing this section of the program as Rev Talks, a moment for our four principal preachers and leaders to share with us some of what they have heard and some of what they have to say to us. So we'll hear from Reverend Dr. Traci Blackmon, from Sister Simone Campbell, from Reverend Dr. James Forbes, and from Reverend Dr. William Barber. And we'll continue to revive ourselves in this call.
The school system tells us one story, and this story is work hard, do what you're told, and one day you can go to college. That's what we want for our kids, right? And I believe this story. I went, I did what I was told, I tried my best, and within two months of senior year of high school, I was accepted into college. First one in my family, first one in my neighborhood. But then I received an email. The email went something like this. Because you have undocumented parents, you must pay out-of-state tuition. And if you know what the price out-of-state tuition is, then you know that for families like me, for families who are first generation here, that's financially impossible.
That's right. I got a 10-year-old son, his name is Ian, and I had to have a conversation with him. I had to have the conversation with him of how he needed to act if the police ever stopped him. I had to tell my 10-year-old son that if they stop you, don't move too fast. If they stop you, put your hands up so they can see your hands. If they stop you, be polite. Say yes, sir. Because it's more important for you to come home at night than anything else. It is important that if they stop you, that you listen to their commands and don't move too fast.
So it's not surprising then to learn that the traditional greeting passed among the Maasai warriors is Kesserian Ungeri, translated, and how are the children? This is still the traditional greeting that they use today. This greeting acknowledges the high value that the Maasai place on children's well-being. What if you wondered how my children were? And I wondered how your children are.
And until the lion tells the story, the hunter will always be the hero. Lions, let them hear us roar. Bless you. Good evening, New York.
Good evening.
I'm a bit emotional. It seems like we only began yesterday. My task tonight is to call us to prayer. What is prayer? Prayer in its most basic form can be defined as an invocation or act that seeks to activate a rapport with the object of one's worship through deliberate communication. Communication that was never intended to be a one-way conversation filled simply with supplications. Although sometimes the burdens that lead us to prayer are so great that this becomes the case. But rather, prayer includes times of petition and listening, a time of adoration and lament, a time of reflection, and a time of action. I am mindful of the West African proverb that states, "When praying, move your feet," which suggests to me our human freedom and indeed a divine mandate to play an active and essential role in our own prayers. It was this proverb and the words of Frederick Douglass when he famously said, "I prayed for freedom for 20 years, but received no answer until I prayed with my legs," that brought me to this righteous work so long ago. I thought it appropriate tonight, my friends, as we gather once again to raise our collective voices to invoke the power of our relationship with the divine, that we be reminded that prayer in Hebrew scripture often becomes one of the ways in which the creature cooperates with the Creator. We see prayer playing this role in the stories of Abraham and Moses and Deborah and Samuel and David and Hagar and others. In fact, it sometimes even seems in the ancient texts that God so desires obedience and cooperation that God is unwilling to carry out God's purpose until the people recognize and honor their participatory role in their own prayer. This causal relationship is not as clearly spelled out in Christian texts, which may account for some of our comfort in thinking we can just talk about justice and not be about justice. I suggest to you tonight that a call to prayer is a call to act, to speak out not on behalf of any political agenda, but to speak out on behalf of God's agenda. A moral agenda, an agenda that includes shelter for the homeless and care for the sick, food for those who don't have enough to eat, inclusion for those who are left out, and righteousness for those who have been wronged. It is certainly not to escape our responsibility for action, but rather to enter into this human-divine partnership in which we offer ourselves at God's disposal, expecting and seeking God to be at work to make our efforts effective. I am not suggesting that work and prayer are the same. They are not. Work is not a substitute for prayer. They are not to be equated with one another, yet they are not to be separated from one another. In other words, prayer must include the obedience of one's convictions and the willingness to act to seek what is good and what is just. Prayer, my friends, is about having a holy hustle. Prayer should make our hearts tender towards the things of God. Just the other day, I was in Evansville, Indiana, where I met a pastor that relayed to me the story of a five-year-old little boy in Sunday school class. It seems that for some reason, this little boy had not equated people sleeping outside with them not having anywhere to go. And on this particular Sunday, he asked his parents as they drove by this familiar spot where often people slept outside, he asked his parents, "Why are they sleeping out there?" And the parent told him they had nowhere to go. The little boy began to cry uncontrollably. He cried because he said it was wrong not to have shelter. Prayer prayers should awaken us to know what is wrong in the world. But whether we are called as believers to move in one direction or another, we are all called to transform this world. So I ask you tonight to join me in prayer, my friends. Pray for a country that cares for the poor. Pray for a country that offers healing for the sick. Pray for a country that understands clean water and healthy food are human rights. Pray for a country that works for those who are working honorable jobs, that they should get honorable wages. Pray for a country that offers all of its rights to all of its people. Pray for a country that chooses people over pipelines. People over school to prison pipelines. People over poverty pipelines. And yes, people over the Dakota Access Pipeline. Mindful that the same hands we lift in prayer are the same hands that will pull levers in the voting booth tomorrow. That the same eyes that we read sacred texts with are the same eyes that will read names on a ballot tomorrow. That the same hearts that compel us to demand justice in the streets are to compel us to demand justice in the State House and justice in the White House. Dormant prayer must not be a substitute for responsible action and the pursuit of justice. Let us rise up tomorrow, my friends, and pray with our feet.
Please join me in my litany response. We must have a moral revival. Bus again.
Who issue oppressed should do justly. Love, mercy. Walk humbly with God. The Lord require of thee. What doth the Lord require of thee? But to do
I'm a 39-year-old wife to a disabled husband. I work at Burger King, as you can see. I make $8.50 an hour. Working at Burger King for low wages really affects me and my family because my husband and I both have health issues. We barely can make ends meet. And right now, because of the lawmakers blocking health care and Medicaid expansion, we can't get the medical insurance or the assistance that we need. He's got a defibrillator in his chest. His medication is over $600 a month that we can't afford because we have no insurance. Okay, lawmakers, take a walk in my shoes. Take a walk in everybody's shoes that is fighting for this fight. We're not fighting just to fight. We are fighting for a reason.
So we got to have a movement that has some heart.
We need a movement that cares about love and justice for everybody. Because down in our hearts, we still believe right can be actualized and justice can be mobilized and meanness can be neutralized and the beloved community can be actualized. We need a heart, yeah, that will fight for what's right.
In this season, when some want to harden and stop the heart of our democracy, we are being called, like our foremothers and fathers, to be the moral defibrillators of our time. We must shock this nation with the power of love. We must shock this nation with the power of mercy. We must shock this nation and fight for justice for all. We can't give up on the heart of our democracy. Not now, not ever.
We can't give up on the heart of our nation, on the heart of democracy. But in order to do that, I would like to propose that what that means is that our hearts are broken open to the needs of our brothers and sisters. And it's a broken-hearted reality that will bring us together and make change. In Charlotte, I met Melinda last week, who's 54 years old. Melinda lost her job in a fancy bank position. She lost her job in the recession, and she couldn't find another one. Her two kids had to move out of the house because they were losing it in foreclosure. She ended up unemployed, uninsured, and homeless. It wasn't until she got help from the YWCA where she finally had a place to stay. She's working a minimum wage waitressing job, working for tips, basically. And she said to me she's working circles around the 20-year-olds, but she doesn't know how long she can go on. And there's no future in that. In Indianapolis, I met Thomasina, a mother of two, probably in her late 20s or early 30s. She was so proud that she had sold her clunker car for $150 so she could do something she had never experienced. She bought her two children brand new school clothes so that they would flourish in this school and not be ridiculed. A mom's gift to her kids. But then she told me she was afraid to vote because she didn't want to do anything that would hurt our nation. And all she saw on the television were negative ads, and she didn't know who she could trust or where she could go. It broke my heart to know that a woman wanting to vote thought the responsible thing was not to do it. Who are we that we don't speak of the truth of our engagement, that we only speak of tearing down and not building up? Thomasina needs another story. In Ohio, I met Michael, a 42-year-old father of three who was proud his kids had graduated from college, but he was angry. I think they would even say he was pissed. He was angry that he had worked hard and played by the rules and was in the same struggling position that he had been 20 years earlier. He was angry that he hadn't gotten ahead. He was furious. He was supporting Donald Trump because he thought maybe a rich person would help the rest of us out. And while it's tempting to laugh or to scoff, his anger touched me deeply because he said to me, "My kids don't even have a fair chance. They got their AA degrees, but they don't have jobs. They don't have a future. What's going to happen to us?" And I knew his anger was of a dad fiercely protecting his kids, and of a child himself feeling disappointed that he didn't measure up to his parents' expectations. In Fort Wayne, I met Layla, who struggles with mental illness, and she finally has her mental illness pretty much under control with medication, and her kids and she have finally moved into permanent housing. She was rejoicing. But then she said, "How do you move forward when the cookie cutter doesn't have room for me or my children?" And what I realized was that this challenge we face, the challenge of the heart, the challenge of conscience, is a challenge to open ourselves wide to all the stories, to all the people in our nation, and say, fear not. Fear not, because we are community. We are together. We will have your back. We will be with you. The challenge of our time is to break out of our individualism, to break out of our fear, to break out of this isolation. We are called to let our hearts be broken open by the stories of everyone. And in having our hearts broken open, we know we're not alone. And when we're not alone, we are people of courage. We are people of creativity. We are people of compassion. We are people of mercy. We are people of hope. Let us be together tonight, November 8th, November 9th, November 10th, and let us vote, but let us act. Let us pray with our feet. Let us pray with our hands. Let us open our hearts, because we, the people of the United States, we, the people of this globe, we, the people who care for the 100%, can be the change we seek. It is that that is the source of the conscience of our nation. Let us pray.
We must have a moral revival.
My son, a first-time offender, age 24, college educated, still in school at the time, on his own. He was charged and he had to go to court, and we basically, the family said, you own up to your part or what you've done. They wanted him to do a plea bargain. We hired a lawyer. His pre-sentencing report from the parole and probation, the professional said 3 to 5 years. 3 to 5 years. My son received a sentence with 21 letters of leniency requested on his behalf. My son, at the end of the day, received not 3 to 5 years, he received 128 years. To make matters worse, in 1995, we learned they had abolished parole. Therefore, my son would have to do 85% at the minimum, 100%, but 85% if he never got in trouble, on 128 years. All I know is when my son heard that, he basically said, my life is over. He could not understand it. He said, Ma, I did the right thing. I confessed to what I admitted what I did.
The Cosmic Association for the elimination of injustice everywhere. God is recruiting you. I want to know, are you willing to be a part of the party? Are you willing to be a part of that association? Are you willing to say, dear my Lord, send me, let me be a part of that association? I've made up my mind. Lord, here am I. Here am I, send me. I may not do everything I ought to do, but I stand in opposition to anything. I don't like it if it's against white folks.
I don't like it if it's against black folks. I don't like it if it's against poor white folks. And I don't like it if it's against poor black folks. If it's injustice, I'm against it.
The words I share with you are entitled God's Email to America. These are very crucial times in a nation with so much anger, so much anxiety about the future, so many unaddressed fears, conflicts, and self-doubts. We must be very careful not to fall prey to the siren call of those who are peddlers of false hopes, illusions, and lies. We need a rendezvous with the God of truth, justice, compassion, and peace. Our currency bears the motto, "In God we trust." If there is any truth in that declaration, we would do well to hear a word from the Lord as we prepare to vote for the leadership and direction of our country. There is some wisdom from the Bible that should be required reading for all who are preparing to decide the destiny of this nation. I offer it in the form of an email from God to America. So, from your Creator, sent Sunday, November 6, 2016, to all citizens of the United States, subject: notes before your presidential vote. My precious Americans, native-born immigrants, independents, Green Party people, Republicans, and Democrats, I send this message on the eve of your national election to alert you to some issues you may have overlooked during the campaign season. When anger, depression, and despair reach epidemic levels in a society, the electorate becomes highly vulnerable to pernicious efforts to manipulate and mobilize people against one another, their government, and the fundamental values they have held through the years. Such was the condition in Germany at the end of World War I. I write to warn you not to be beguiled by the temptation to abandon your country's commitment to freedom and justice for all, or to seek security and greatness in walled-off enclosures of hatred, bitterness, and xenophobic arrogance. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, a German professor who taught at Union Theological Seminary in New York before returning to his homeland and eventual execution in an extermination camp, made clear that true freedom is not a freedom from me or from each other, but freedom for neighbors with me, say. Genuine freedom is always relational. Whoever promises to lift your nation to new heights of dignity, honor, and prosperity without an honest facing of the tragic flaws of its national life is either intentionally misleading you or totally lacking in a basic understanding of your situation. So let me remind you of some dramatic events from the dawn of creation that were designed to set humankind on the path to being a just society. The principles derived from some episodes within Genesis 2:18 through 4:18 may help to avert the possible disaster of national calamity. After creating Adam, I gave him the authority to name the animals. This was my way of inviting him to partner with me in the creative process. This was my way of teaching. I gave to Adam and Eve, I gave instructions to not eat from one of the trees of the garden. This was my way of teaching them that mature human beings are expected to make choices. They must respect boundaries and know the consequences that follow from the choices they make. Creatures made in my image and likeness are honored with the power to make choices. The quality of their lives are affected by their cultivation of moral discipline and wisdom in their decisions and actions. Moral agency is my gift to all human beings. This is why the vote is so important. Anyone who robs another of the freedom to vote is dangerously tampering with my design for humankind. At this point in the story, the serpent enters with the intention of putting enmity between my created beings and me. It convinces them that my restrictions are designed to diminish their freedom and power, and that I was attempting to deceive them about the consequences of their behavior. Don't get bogged down in a literal analysis of what the forbidden fruit was or whether they would have lived forever had they finally eaten from the tree of life. It is sufficient to observe that they made an unwise vote, and that human history bears evidence that our votes do matter. Notice also that what had once been natural became a cause of guilt and shame. They discovered they were naked. We are reminded that the rigor of political campaigning may expose the inadequacy of the fig leaves we stitch together to hide the embarrassing truths about ourselves. Don't overlook the fact, however, that I forgave Adam and Eve, and in my never-failing love, I made garments to cover and comfort them. Finally, there is the story of Cain and Abel. This may be the most important lesson for these days of violence, character assassination, and policy proposals with life and death implications. Human beings are prone to violent impulse whenever they experience diminishment, dismissal, or disgrace. The human will to live within instinctively recoils against threats to one's life, health, or well-being. Incidentally, this impulse is one of my gifts that comes with life, to help fortify individuals against forces that seek to destroy them. The triggering of this internal alarm offers both destructive and constructive alternatives. The serpent prompts the reptilian response of destroying the threat before one is destroyed by it. Alternatively, the will to live may be used to promote and sustain life rather than to destroy it. As will be made clear later, I love both Cain and Abel. But the shape of the narrative dramatizes what happens when human beings feel they have been mistreated. When Cain felt that his brother Abel had been unjustly regarded more positively than himself, his rage was inconsolable. I told him that he had better master his anger, or it would certainly master him. He voted to honor the reptilian impulse to hatred and violence rather than to heed my admonition to master it and use its power towards constructive ends. When he had lured his brother into the field, murdered and buried him, I could still hear the blood of Abel crying out of the ground. Cain denied responsibility for being his brother's keeper or even knowing where he was. I exposed his fratricidal transgression and the consequences of his internal vote to murder his brother. When Cain complained that his punishment was more than he could bear and that anyone who found him would wish to kill him, I declared one of my strongest decrees, making a gesture that could keep my dream of creation from becoming a nightmare. I said, "Not so! This violence must stop!" I then put my mark upon his forehead as a sign forbidding anyone to kill him. As the account ends, Cain gets married, has a son named Enoch, uses his energy to build a city, and names it for his son. Now that's the way the story of creation should end. Using the gift of life, the will to power, and the will to live, to vote, work, and to building cities and civilizations that are safe for dreams. That's what I am calling American citizens to do, both with their vote on Tuesday and their continuing efforts beyond the election to build the beloved community. Thank you. LOL from LOL. Let me close by saying the tone of that email was somewhat troubling. I thought it was true. I felt it might even be disturbing. Hoped that it might be enlightening. But I was still concerned, is there a word from the Lord? So I went to church this morning, and my pastor, Reverend Jesse T. Williams at Convent Avenue Baptist Church, gave just this, and it only takes a minute to tell you what he said, but it has powerful significance for each of us here tonight. He read from Exodus 15, where after crossing the Red Sea, going through the wilderness, sure, that the people came upon a place called Mara, meaning bitter, and they complained because of the bitter waters. Then, when Moses spoke to the Lord gave Moses instructions, cut down a tree and throw it in the water. And the waters were sweetened. And then the text goes on to say, after that, they left Mara and went to Elim. And this is what it said about Elim. In Elim, there were 12 springs of water and 70 palm trees. And I said, that's it. Americans, fellow citizens, and those of you who are gathered here with us tonight, we've all been in the throes of bitterness. It does not matter what side of the coin you've been looking at, what party you've been praying for, and what party you've been praying against. We all got some bitterness. The word that the Lord seems to say to me is, number one, All of this takes place after the liberation at the Red Sea. Guess what, folks? We've been through struggles as long as I can remember, and when I read history, as long as this nation's been going. And every election, people say, oh God, if my candidate loses, I don't know what we're gonna do. We're gonna go across the border, or we're gonna get a passport for somewhere. Folks, the Lord has delivered us across many a Red Sea. Sometimes the sea is red and sometimes the sea is blue, but the Lord delivers us. Yes, we end up with some bitterness, but the word to America, America, we cannot afford to hang too long at Mara, whether the victory is sweet or leaves us in bitterness. We had better turn our spirits towards Elam. I wish we would be delivered tonight from our depression, our anxiety, our troubledness, and decide that whoever wins, we'll look to the Lord who brought us across the Red Sea before. Ain't no need to tear it up just because it doesn't go your way. I want to say that to us. But then, for everybody tonight, I'm telling you what I'm doing. I'm making up my mind to do what the Lord leads me to do. I'm going to ask the Lord. I'm going to ask the Lord what to do, which way to vote. I'm going to ask if I need to ask the Lord. I'm going to ask the Lord what to do. And then if the Lord gives me the tree, I'm going to vote. Every time I vote, I'm enacting what God told me was the best for me and for my people and for God's people, which incidentally includes all people. And if I do that, I'm prepared to turn my spirit towards Elam, where there'll be 12 springs of water. Take a good swig of refreshing water, and then 70 palm trees. Sit down and relax myself. And you brought us through, and we trust that no matter what happens, we're still in your hands.
I now invite the entire congregation to stand and sing that. And at the end of your singing the chorus, I ask you, as they continue to sing, that you pass the peace to one another. Because the goal is to be one people under God. No matter how things go, one people under God. Brothers and sisters of multiple faiths and traditions and ethnicities, one people under God.
Just
justice is coming soon.
Thank you. just a little while longer. Pray on. Just a little while longer. Pray on. Just a little while longer. You know that everything
just
gonna be all right. Now home in the South, we give God a praise right there. Somebody ought to. God, we thank you for your mercy and your grace. We thank you for sufficient strength to do that which you have called us to do. Continue, O God, to use human lips to speak words of life. For we ask it in the name of the great Spirit that rests, rules, and abides above, through, and with all of us. In your name, amen. I'm glad to get here. The plane was held up on the tarmac, but I'd rather get here in one piece than get here in pieces. I want to, first of all, thank so many people that have been a part of us being able to travel and do this revival. The Riverside Church, Auburn Seminary, Union Theological Seminary, Middle Church, have all been so kind, so gracious, so merciful. Reverend Amy Butler, you have been such a blessing, and your recent story in the news has been such a blessing to so many and ministered to so many. We call him the street genie. You would know him as Freddie Green, but down in North Carolina, we call him the street genie. Let's thank God for him. Twenty-two states right now are having watch gatherings of this time tonight. And I was just told that the Mall Revivals call to prayer, Dr. Forbes, and truth and conscience and healing and action is trending number 5 in the world on social media and headed toward 4. I want to combine what would have been my earlier remarks and then move into the call to action. In the spring of 2015, Sister Serene Jones, our president, and Brother Fred Davey allowed me to take a break and come to Union for a prayer and study sabbatical. I spent time reading sacred text on justice, both in the Old and the New Testament, and even picked up some texts from the Quran. I read economist Joseph Stiglitz's book, The Cost and the Price of Inequality, and several other pieces of literature in that regard. I read extensively The Mailman School of Public Policy's study on poverty and how much death is caused simply because of poverty. I read The Prophetic Fire by Cornel West and had conversations with James Cone in my small apartment and reread Dr. James Forbes's book, Preaching and the Holy Spirit. I spent a lot of time with Liz Theo Harris and her sister, who wrote the book on the radical life of Rosa Parks. I was tired and I came to reflect on the meaning of the Moral Monday movement in North Carolina and beyond. By this time, we had had over 1,200 people that had been arrested, traveled to other states, and we were going on 2 years of challenging civil disobedience. And then in the midst of that, one day in that little apartment, I felt a move of the need for a moral revival across the country, but I didn't trust it. I didn't trust it alone, because revelation must be confirmed so that it's not just some narcissistic attention-getting agenda for yourself, but truly something you're willing to lend yourself to a greater cause. So I shared it with Dr. Forbes. I'd always been a great admirer of Dr. Forbes. And I found that he had been having the same similar pull of the spirit. We agreed to begin with the goal of a mere 7 states. That's a good biblical number, we thought. Thought we could do that. We had no resources. We just had a revelation. We had no provision. We just had a vision. We had no funders. We just had our faith. But we were going to do it somehow, some way. We announced it at the Sam Proctor conference, not knowing the political atmosphere that was headed toward America. We just said yes in 2015. We announced it at the Sam Proctor conference, and Dr. Traci Blackmon got full of the spirit, changed the program at the end of the announcement, called for impromptu prayer with tears in her eyes, led the entire conference of preachers to the altar, and said this is something whose time has come and it did not need to be stopped through the bureaucracy of that we sometimes get meshed in. But she did add one caveat from the spirit. She said there must be some prophetesses. She agreed to join with no provisions, just a vision. No funding, just faith. I had been in conversation earlier that year and had a transformative 30 minutes when the fellas broke us out from Auburn in a retreat, and I happened to get the assignment to sit with Sister Simone for 30 minutes, just listening and talking. I had been an admirer of hers as well, but to hear her that day talk about, we talked about despair, and there was another sister there, my Muslim sister, where is she? She's here. Where's Linda? Linda, she had to leave. The three of us were together, Catholic, Muslim, and Christian, Protestant. And we talked about our own struggles, our own despairs, our own hurt. And then Sister Simone said, but it's only from that place you can get to hope anyway. You have to go there. Put a call, and she said yes. And on April 3rd, 2016, 49 years after Dr. King's sermon, Time to Break Silence, delivered probably almost in this very spot, we began this journey. Little did we know that God would not only send us provision and modest provision and help, but God would require more than our puny little 7-state vision. When we said yes, it was as though we spoke to a hunger that God had simply been looking for some bodies to stand in the gap. Because Ezekiel 22 says that when the preachers and the politicians have become like ravaging wolves, and are devouring the people and hurting the poor and mistreating the immigrants. God is always looking for somebody to stand in the gap. We announced it and the phone started ringing. The staff team that was with us, Roz Pellis and others, just started coming. Can we be a part? Will you come to our state? Before we knew it, Sister Duke, 7 went to 15 states and then 22. And we finally just had to say, we can't do them all. Maybe next year, but physically we just couldn't do anymore. In every place, from New York to Birmingham, from Georgia to Missouri, twice in Missouri, we trained clergy of all faiths, even those who did not claim faith but believe in a moral arc. We pulled together activists, rabbis, millennials, older activists, around the same table, imams, around the moral agenda. And for some reason, people didn't come to fight about their individual. It was almost like an idea whose time had come. In every city, our theomusicologist, Yara Allen, summoned artists who were so glad that they were finally being summoned to be a part of something about the moral agenda. They came and added their prophetic moral chords and words to the call. Every place we went, people testified and put a face on the pain caused by extreme policies that are morally indefensible, constitutionally inconsistent, and economically insane. We cried a lot. The testimonies became the center of the service. People thanked us for just allowing a platform where they could be real. And then suddenly, one of our goals, the media, began to call to talk about morality from a perspective much broader than the so-called religious right. All of a sudden, media were calling and said, I hadn't heard this. I didn't know there was another kind of evangelicalism. I had not heard these texts. Over and over they started calling in every city, papers and radio and TV, CNN and MSNBC. Even persons who had bought in to the extremism of the so-called religious right that too often is a form of theological malpractice that borders on heresy. But during these revivals, people would come up to us and said, I have been thinking like that, but these revivals, this preaching, these texts, these songs have opened mine eyes. And I see things in a new light. Young people, I remember in Birmingham, came up afterwards and said, Reverend Barber, if we could go to church like this, we would do it all the time. We didn't even know about all of these people in the church who also understand what it means to be in the street. Quakers came together. Now they were kind of quiet, but even the Quakers. One day we were in Philadelphia, and one of the Quaker sisters afterwards got real quiet and looked up in the balcony as though she could see the ancestors and gave us the greatest compliment, said, I see the light. And a hush fell over the place. Unitarians joined in. I went to a Unitarian worldwide event and expected very different kind of experience than I had and had in my life. They had a Pentecostal choir, and by the time it was over, the Unitarian, Rabbi Jacobs, and the imam were shouting on the side. I said, Lord, what's going on here? What's going on here? UCCs came in, disciples, Pentecostals, Baptists, Jews, Muslims, Native Americans or indigenous people, Sikhs, Hindus came together. And on September the 12th, in 32 states simultaneously, clergy of all faith joined with activists and impacted persons and delivered a moral agenda simultaneously to 32 state capitals, 32 governors, 32 senators, well, actually 64 senators, declaring that we're serving notice that even after this election, we're not going back home. We even declared this higher ground moral agenda to each national party. We were in Cleveland, we were in Philadelphia. Even when we were held up and threatened with arrest, we still stood firm and pushed forward. And so now, after 8 months, we believe a seed has been sown. And some water is being applied. And God will give the increase. We are clear, you know, God, Moses asked the question, God, how will I know I've done what you told me to do? God said, go that way, leave the mountain, go that way, and when you end up back on this same mountain. So we're here at this riverside at this same mountain, and we can see clearer now that in America, it is time to move beyond a left and right, liberal versus conservative agenda, and strive for higher ground and a moral agenda in this country. We believe that we must break silence as Dr. King did 50 years ago. And that our moral traditions have a firm foundation upon which to stand against the divide and conquer strategies of extremists. We believe in a moral agenda that stands against systemic racism and classism and poverty and xenophobia and any attempt to promote hate toward members of the human family. And we claim a higher ground in partisan debate. We are calling on this country to return public discourse to our deepest moral and constitutional values, because this is the only hope for us to be one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Turn this up some. We have come tonight, this hour, because our generation is once again being called to be the moral dissenters. We're being called to prayer. We're being called to conscience. We're being called to truth. We're being called to healing. And we're being called to action. And we, I believe, must accept this calling. Tonight, after Dr. Blackmon and Sister Simone and Dr. Forbes, my task was to talk about this call to action and call to vote. And in light of where we are now, America, things are quite serious. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We have not seen the attempt to delegitimize our democracy and delegitimize black, brown, and progressive white votes like this since 100 years ago, Woodrow Wilson played the Birth of a Nation in the Oval Office. A movement that was all about declaring that the progress that had been made on the first Reconstruction was fraudulent and rigged. And in this election season, within this democratic experience called America, I want to use a word that my mother used to use whenever she was serious. My mother used the word, six letters, better. If I was outside playing when I was supposed to be studying, my mother would come to the door. I don't know about your family, but in my family, she did not say, "Billy, I would like it if you would come in this house." My mother didn't come in and said, "Billy, let's have time out so we can negotiate whether or not you're gonna come in and do your homework." My mother did not call because she knew as a young black man born in 63, I always had to have my game on. So she did not come to the door and say, "Son, it would be very nice of you if you would come in." My mother said, "Boy, you better come in here." And I want to suggest to America, using my mother's word, we better vote. Now, Susie Kasem reminds us of the obligation in her book, Rise Up and Salute the Sun, that we are called to choose leaders who will invest in building bridges, not walls, books, not weapons, intellectualism and wisdom, not ignorance, stability, not fear and terror, love, not hate, fairness, not hypocrisy, substance, not superficiality, character, not immaturity, transparency, not secrecy, justice, not lawlessness, environmental improvement and preservation, not destruction, truth and not lies. We better vote. Lyndon Baines Johnson once said, "A man without a vote is a man without protection." We better vote. Dr. King said 50 years ago, "There must be a concerted effort on the part of Negro leaders to arouse their people from their apathetic indifference. In the past, apathy was a moral failure, but today, apathy is a form of moral and political suicide." We better vote. Shirley Chisholm, that first woman to run for president from the streets of New York, she said, "You don't make progress by standing on the sidelines, whimpering and complaining. You make progress by implementing ideas and then electing people to implement those ideas." We better vote. Abraham Lincoln said, "Elections belong to the people. It's their decision. If they decide to turn their backs on the fire and burn their behinds, then they will just have to sit on the blisters." We better vote. We better vote. Because voting is a constitutional right and a spiritual right. In our faith tradition, personhood comes from God, and the only people that can vote are persons. You have to be 18 years or older, born or a person born or naturalized in these United States. Personhood comes from God, being made in the image of God. Therefore, any attempt to deny the right to vote is an attempt to subvert and deny the image of God in every human being. That is why 2,600 years ago, before America was ever a country, Isaiah said from God, "Woe unto those who legislate evil and rob the poor of their rights and make women and children their prey." We better vote. But not only must we better vote, we better understand and not get caught up in the distractions. We got schoolhouse politics going on. You know, schoolyard, schoolhouse politics. If you wanted to get out of a test, you get somebody to start a fight, and everybody say, "Fight!" And that's what some people have tried to do in this election cycle, huh? And then some want us to be focused on hairdos and pantsuits and how loud someone is and certain emails and certain kinds of other Twitter and stuff. No, we don't or shouldn't. We do not nor should we just vote based on that kind of foolish emotionalism. We shouldn't just vote based on party or personality. We should look at policy. Policy. And the truth of the matter is, we better vote because this election, truly, like every election, in many ways is about whether or not lies, insult, intimidation, division, racism, and xenophobia can win over truth, ideas, integrity, issues, and inequality. God help America if we don't make it clear which way we're going. We better vote. This election is about policies. It's about these kind of questions. Will we fund public education and support teachers? Or will we underfund public education and take public money and give it to private schools that will foster more resegregation and inequality? That's what's at stake. Will we give more tax cuts to the greedy? Or will we ensure living wages, $15 and a union, to the working poor, of which there are 64 million Americans in that category, 54% of them are African American? That's what's at stake. Will we elect politicians at the state and the federal level who will truly seek to address the great moral shame of poverty in America? I know none of them will do it in perfection, but the question is, will they even try? The richest nation in the world, it's a shame. Our child poverty, our poverty. Will we elect people that will tell the truth about poverty? That there are 8 million more poor whites than there are blacks in poverty. 5 million more poor whites than there are Latinos in poverty. And that the social safety nets and programs of the war on poverty did work until they were undermined. And that poverty cannot be dealt with by simply through charity, tax cuts to the wealthy, blaming poverty on the immorality of the poor, and giving somebody a turkey once or twice a year and thinking you've done something. This is what is at stake. Will we do that, or will we elect politicians that suggest poverty is a black problem? That mainly poverty and poor people are lazy. That causes poor whites to vote against their own self-interest, when in fact black people and poor white people and poor Latinos need to be forming allies against the oligarchy that's fooling us all. Will we elect people who peddle the untruth that poverty is the result of the actions of a black president? Will we elect politicians who themselves get free health care, but when they get elected, they then want to repeal and deny other Americans getting what they have received, especially the poor and the working poor? Or will we elect politicians that will expand health care to everybody and recognize it not just as a policy, but as a basic human right? We better vote. The issue in this election, from the White House to the State House, is will we elect persons that will seek to give corporations more power than people? Will we elect persons that will honor the legitimate discontent raised by Black Lives Matter about police brutalities and shooting and the prison industrial complex? People who will seek to address the brokenness of our criminal justice system and free innocent black men and women? Or will we elect people who will distort the truth and say that the legitimate critique against bad police is really a distorted attack on all police, when they know that is not true? Will we elect people that will simply say what America simply needs is more law and order and stricter prison sentences, not reform and justice? Will we elect persons who seek to protect the environment? Or will we elect those who will deregulate companies and pollution as long as they will let pollution roll out, as long as the lobby money rolls in their pockets? We better vote. Will we elect persons who honor the equal rights of all people? LGBTQ, black people, brown people, Native American? Or will we elect those who exploit and embrace discrimination and racism and homophobia and division for their own selfish gain? Will we at least have a grown-up conversation about racism in America, or will we keep denying it? Will we elect persons who will set our Supreme Court back and make it more extreme, or who are committed to equality and the common defense and the general welfare and the establishment of justice? Will we elect persons who understand America is a country of immigrants, that says, give me your tired, your poor, and your huddled masses yearning to be free? Or will we elect persons that will tear down the great legacy of the Statue of Liberty, build walls instead of welcome mats? Will we sing America, America, God shed his grace on us, but then refuse grace to people if they are Hispanic or Haitian or brown or black? That is the choice in America. In fact, as a theologically evangelical, liberal, conservative, charismatic, liberationist biblicist who follows a brown-skinned Palestinian Jew who was profiled by the state, never charged for medical assistance, who lived among the poor, the question from that perspective for me in this election, the policy question is, will we elect politicians and their allies who attempt to use religion in the service of hate and harm, who try to claim that the only moral issues in the public square is where you stand on homosexuality, prayer in the school, a woman's right to choose, gun rights, tax cuts, who will claim that this is the evangelical position, which is actually a form of malpractice? Or will we in this election demand a moral revolution of values that says the deepest, most important religious values in the public square is where do you stand on policies that lift the poor, the broken, the bruised, the captive, and all of those who have been made to feel unaccepted? Will America face the reality that God is going to judge every nation, and God will not judge every nation ultimately by your GNP? God will raise some questions. When I was hungry, America, did you feed me? When I was naked, did you clothe me? When I was sick, did you heal me? When I was in prison, did you visit me? Because inasmuch as you've done it unto the least of these, you've done it unto me. That is what is at stake. So we better vote. And in voting, I'm reminded, Dr. Forbes, Traci, and Sister Simone, what God said to Moses and the Israelites. I didn't talk to Dr. Forbes. He went to verse 15 because the Holy Ghost had me in chapter 14. Yeah, God had him in chapter 15 getting past the bitterness and getting to the oasis. But God had me in chapter 14 saying, before you can get there, you got to come through the Red Sea. Oh, have mercy. And the Red Sea is in a precarious position. When you get to the Red Sea, you got mountains on both sides. And you've got Pharaoh coming up on your rear. And you have the Red Sea in the middle. And God said, go back, and the Spirit said, go back and check what happened in that scene. Moses got scared. And while he was scared, the people started complaining. Why do we have to deal with this kind of election? That's what they said. Why did you bring us out here? At least in Egypt we had graves, and at least we had something to eat. Now we're out here. We hear Pharaoh's chariots coming. The polls tell us something's coming. We can't get out of here. Left and right is blocked up. Way forward is blocked. And Moses got scared and said, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. And a whole lot of preachers have messed that text up. Because they're lazy and they don't want to get involved. They say, stand still. But that was a scared Moses. That wasn't God's spirit. You got to keep reading on down. God said, Moses, when you're in a time and the battle is between Pharaoh and freedom, truth and lies, injustice and justice, hate and love, moral agents can't stand still. They must go forward. In fact, not only must they go forward, they must look at what's in their hand. They may not have Pharaoh's chariots, but I've always given my people something. And God said, what's in your hand? He said, you got to raise your voice. You got to raise your vote, your moral dissent. Because whenever we're in this kind of a clear choice, somebody has to stand and not just give up. Could it be that God is saying to us, America, what's in your hand? Could it be that God is saying, use what's in your hand? You got a vote in your hand. Use what's in your hand. If you have a car in your hand, drive somebody to vote. If you got a truck in your hand, haul somebody to vote. If you got a bus in your hand, load somebody to vote. If you've got a cell phone in your hand, call somebody to vote. If you've got a Facebook in your hand, FaceTime somebody to vote. If you've got Twitter in your hand, tweet somebody to vote. If you've got Periscope in your hand, raise it and get somebody to vote. If you've got Instagram, Instagram somebody and send them to vote. And if somebody's in your house and they're 18 years or older and they're eating your food and drinking your water and they're talking about they're not gonna vote, get you a stick. And get them by the hand. Tell them what my mama said. You better vote. Use what you have to get what you need in this hour. 58 years after Brown versus Board of Education, we better vote. 61 years after the murder of Emmett Till, we better vote. 56 years after the sit-ins in Greensboro, we better vote. 52 years after Fannie Lou Hamer said there comes a time when you get sick and tired of being sick and tired, we better vote. 53 years after the death of Mega Evers, we better vote. 53 years since the March on Washington, we better vote. 53 years since four little girls were blown up in a Birmingham church, we better vote. 52 years since the signing of the Civil Rights Act, we better vote. 51 years since Bloody Sunday, 51 years since the Voting Rights Act, 51 years since Malcolm was killed, 48 years since Martin was assassinated, 47 years since my parents integrated public schools, and 7 years since Barack Hussein Obama became president of these United States. And they said it couldn't happen. And they call him everything but a child of God, a lie, a juvenile, unfit, un-American. But every time he walks into the Congress, they still have to say, hello, Mr. President. We better vote. We better vote. We better vote like never before. Take what's in your hand. With less, our parents beat Jim Crow. With less, they beat lynching. With less, they beat the KKK. With less, we must do more with more. Stand on your feet. Ask your neighbor, neighbor, what's in your hands? We better vote. America, what's in your hand? And if we use what's in our hand, God always has a way of showing up. When Moses used what was in his hand, God showed up. The wind started blowing. The sea stood at attention. They walked through on dry ground. They shouted on the other side. Just maybe, if we use what's in our hand, we can walk through some of this racism. Walk through some of this xenophobia. Walk through some of this hatred. Walk through some of this meanness. But in order to do it, we cannot stand still and see the salvation of God. We must be salvific instruments of God. And yes, we have to vote for people who are not perfect. Don't get upset about that, you aren't either. We have to vote for people we don't agree with 100% of the time. Well, you don't agree with Jesus 100% of the time. You don't agree with Allah 100% of the time. You don't agree with Jehovah 100% of the time. We have to vote for people who are mortals like us. But in this time, you've got to look clearly at what kind of mortal are you dealing with? Are you dealing with a model that's stubborn and arrogant and will refuse to do anything but what they want to do? Or are you voting for a model that you can put in office, and then after you put them in office, you can push them in office? Because the last thing I want to say is, we're not just voting to turn the democracy over to the politician. Oh, no, 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 no. We are voting to elect ourselves. When we go to the polls, we are voting to say we refuse to give up on this democracy. We refuse to let America go down the wrong path. We refuse to give up. We refuse to stand down. We are voting to elect ourselves. We are declaring on November the 8th, no more off-year elections, no more abdicating our right to vote, no more standing down. We are going to vote, and we're going to stand, and we're going to fight for the heart and the soul of America with every breath we have. Nonviolently. With love, with grace. That is our call tonight. That is our call tonight. So as you're standing, we want everybody all over the country that are listening and those in this sanctuary to sign the moral pledge card. You've got them. Before you leave, we want you to sign those. Come up, Dr. Forbes and Dr. Blackmon and Sister Simone. Give them a hand. This one. And we want you, in your own tradition. I remember at one of our revivals, a native indigenous American gave us a prayer of the Spirit and turned to the four winds and prayed to the four winds. And I thought about those winds in Ezekiel. And they blew on those dry bones and they became a mighty army. We need you to pray, but prophetic prayer, the kind of prayer that ends, "Thy will be done," the kind of prayer, "For thine is the glory." Yes, the kind of prayer, as Walter Wink used to say, that rattles the cage of God. Because you are unwilling to accept the reality of injustice. And when you pray, you're not praying simply for God to do it. You're praying that prayer that Isaiah prayed, "Lord, here am I, send me." Then we need you to tell everybody you know to go out and vote in this election and never give up on the possibilities of America. I'm always struck, finally, by one text I preached the whole revival. Dr. Forbes let me know the Holy Spirit said during the revival, I couldn't shift that. It's the first time I preached anything different, because he said that message you have to give to the nation, and it always started with Ezekiel 36 and Ezekiel 22, where God looked out and saw all the corruption. He saw politicians taking on the way of animals, wolves. And God said, if I could have found just one, I would have saved the city. He said, I know you all want to focus on what the bad folk are doing. I know you want to focus on what your adversary is doing. But God says, if I could have just found one to stand in the gap. What can God do in America if he could find all of us standing in the gap? If he only needed one to save Israel, what can God do if he finds all of us? If you're willing, with the life you have left, to stand in the gap and stand for justice and love and mercy, raise your hand. Don't worry about who else is looking. Don't worry about all of the folks who are so determined to turn us backwards. God says, if I can just get some folk to use what's in their hands. And why is it so tough right now? Well, the Jewish rabbis have told me that when Moses finally heard God, God didn't just open the sea. In the other renditions of the story, it says Moses had to walk all the way out into the troubled waters.
until the water was up to his nose, but his rod was still stretched out. Then God knew he was serious. And then when, as the waters were troubled, could it be that all the troubling we're seeing is nothing but the precursor of God splitting the waters so we can make it to Elam? Could it be? Could it be that if we don't get afraid, God knows the troubling of the waters? All of that you see is God just getting ready to do a fresh thing in this democracy called America. Tomorrow Monday, stretch out your rod. Black Lives Matter, stretch out your rod. Every church, every denomination, every person of faith, every person not of faith but believes in a moral arc, stretch out your rod. Use what's in your hand and watch God. And while you're doing it, come up here, Mark Thompson, and sing, revive us again. Fill each heart with thy love. Made soul be rekindled with some fire from above. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thine the glory. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Thine the glory. Revive us again. I asked Mark, I wanted him to close this event. He's a radio personality and announcer. I told him to sit down there and get a 1 minute commercial together. A 1 minute commercial. He's also a preacher. Mark, we're trending now about number four, number three in the world.
Yes, sir.
I want you to give a 1 minute promo to the world and to America. Y'all, I want y'all to sing. And we're gonna make our way out to the place. Stretch out what's in our hands.
Sisters and brothers, we are called by God today to make the right choice. And often we are called when we least expect it. Often we have other plans. We make plans ourselves, but God has another plan for all of us. One young man went to school, got his PhD in theology, and planned to come here in this very spot and have Dr. Forbes and Dr. Butler's job while he taught at Union Theological Seminary. But God had another plan and called him to Montgomery. Yes. We must respond in his memory because God has called us and has a plan today. I must say, little did I know God's plan for me. I didn't know until I got here, the Reverend Barber was going to call me here. Nor did I know that just 48 hours ago, my uncle at the age of 76, the first role model in my life, Dr. Forbes, would pass away. And little did I know that as he, Captain Joseph K. Petway Jr., MD, was a Vietnam veteran, I would stand in the place where Dr. King stood for him and all those who fought in Vietnam. I didn't know that. And so we should close with the words that Dr. King gave us right here in this very spot. Amen. Because we must answer God's call according to his plan. And Dr. King said, we have a choice to make here, April 4th, 1967. If we would but make the right choice, we can turn this pending cosmic elegy into a creative psalm of peace. If we would but make the right choice, we would speed up that day when justice will roll down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. We must make the right choice, and we better vote. Amen. And the people of God said, amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Let us stand and sing together.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thine the glory. All the clergy that were on the program.
Hallelujah.
Come on.
Thine
the glory.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.